Matthew chapter 16. I love these words. They're powerful. I love to preach from the Gospels. It says this: when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" So they said, "Some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah." By the way, that Bar-Jonah just simply means son of Jonah. "Blessed are you, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades," or as the King James Version puts it, "the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he commanded his disciples that they should tell no one that he was Jesus the Christ. Amen. Heavenly Father, I just pray that you would take this simple message today, and I pray that you would use it to encourage the faith of your people. I pray that you would lift us, God, up into that heavenly realm, God, to be seated with Jesus, that we might have a new revelation of who he is in our life and the power that he brings. In Jesus' name, amen. As we trace the footsteps of Jesus through the Gospels, and particularly through this book of Matthew, we discover that Jesus and his disciples have been passing through a very busy period of ministry just prior to the events that we read about. The best way to describe the last few days in the lives of Jesus and his disciples before these events would be to use one word, and that would be the word crowds. You see, Jesus had fed the multitudes. He had fed the 5,000. He had fed the 4,000. Miracles were flowing at the hands of Jesus, and the disciples watched in amazement of it all. They saw people coming in faith and touching him and leaving absolutely healed. They saw the crowds bringing those who were lame and blind and possessed by demonic powers and the mute and laying them at the feet of Jesus. And the scripture says that Jesus healed them all, every single one. Jesus was at the height of his popularity, and the multitudes of people were marveling and flocking around him. But you see, Jesus had something else on his agenda besides healing the multitudes, and that was revealing himself to his disciples. He realized that very soon he was going to be going to the cross, and he wanted his disciples to understand exactly who he was so that they could carry on the work that he had called them to do. And so the scripture passage that we reread opens with them coming to a place called Caesarea Philippi. And so they had left the busyness of the crowds around the Sea of Galilee and came to a much smaller area, a much more quiet place. Gone were the dust on the road and the crowds. And in the background now, there was a beautiful mountain called Mount Hermon that they could actually see from Caesarea Philippi. The snow still on the mountain back in the days when Jesus walked on the earth. And yet underlying all of this beauty in this place of such beautiful physical appearance, there was also a spiritual darkness that was there. History tells us that it was a place where the god Pan was worshipped. Pan was the Greek god of desolate places, and there was a large cave there where a spring flowed out. It's still there. It's a tourist attraction today. It was a place where Pan was worshipped, and they actually called that place the Gate of Hell because that river just flowed into the mountain seemingly forever. This area was also known for its worship of Baal, another false popular god of that day. And it also had a place where people worshiped the emperor. You can still go there and see the place where Agrippa was actually worshiped. And all three of these false deities were claiming lordship. They were claiming that they were God. Pan over nature and Baal over fertility. And the emperor claimed to be lord over all of the people. And so it was in this environment of both beauty and spiritual darkness, a place that was quiet, where Jesus decided to question his disciples. And so he says to them, the first question, he says, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And obviously, since they had been with the crowds, right, they would be easy for them to answer that kind of question. They had heard enough people make their comments, and they had had enough discussions, and so they quickly began to share what they knew. Just a few months earlier, John the Baptist had been beheaded, remember, by Herod because of his sharp and strong preaching. And when John the Baptist heard that Jesus was doing miracles around, he had a fear that John the Baptist had somehow risen from the dead, and other people had caught on to that. And so some were saying that Jesus was John the Baptist. Because these people were Jews, they understood an Old Testament passage that said Elijah must come again, and we know that that's to be true, right, in the end times. So some of them said, "Hey, listen," they thought Jesus was Elijah. Others said Jeremiah. Others said some of the prophets. And then, in a very powerful moment, Jesus turned the question a little bit to his disciples, and he said these words. He said, "Who do you say that I am?" Now you have to understand that these were the men that Jesus was closest to. They knew him. They walked with him. They had seen all that he had done. So it was a powerful moment, and he was really wanting them to proclaim his supremacy in a place where there was spiritual darkness. Come on. He was wanting them to declare him as King and him as Lord and him as Christ and him as God, even in this place of spiritual darkness. And so this question today really is for you and for me as well, and it's a powerful question for you today, because let me ask you this question: who is Jesus to you? Who do you say that Jesus is? In today's world, there are a lot of theories or answers that are given, and that brings a lot of responses, because the world has plenty to say about who Jesus was. Some would kind of see him as a heavenly Santa Claus that's going to fill their stocking with all kinds of toys and wealth. And obviously, there are those in our world today who would claim that Jesus was not who he claimed to be. They would say that Jesus is a scam artist, that he was a fake, they would try to rewrite history to say that there never was a man by the name of Jesus who was a miracle worker who walked on the face of the earth. And then there are others who give him some honest admiration, but it's not in the complete revelation of who he is. They would say things like this. They would say Jesus was a great teacher. How many of you know that he was? They would say Jesus was a poet who wrote beautiful sayings that we're to think about and meditate about. Even today, philosophers revere Jesus as a great thinker. Ethicists call him a great moral example. Liberal religionists say he provided the model of how that we should live. Even rock stars have sung that Jesus Christ is the superstar. But in every case, that claim and pronouncement of the people many times falls short to who he really is. Because how many of you realize that he's really much greater than all of that? Amen? And I love the words of Peter, right? Peter, by revelation of the Father, gave a powerful proclamation to who Jesus is. When Jesus said, "Who do you say that I am?" The scripture tells us that Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." This was not something he'd figured out on his own. This didn't come from his own mind. This was something that had been revealed to him by his Father in heaven. Jesus was the Christ. That means the Messiah. That means the anointed one. And besides that, he was not a son of the living God. He was the Son Son of the living God. He was the only begotten of the Father. Come on. And if he's the Son of God, then that makes him deity. Come on. Jesus Christ always has been, always will be the Son of the living God. He's deity. He's God. Come on. Can we give him a hand of praise today? Amen. And what makes this so astonishing is that this was the first time that anyone had given such an accurate and powerful portrayal of his personhood. And you see this passage, even though it's relatively simple, it really has two powerful challenges for you and for me, all right? This is for you and for me. And the first challenge is this. The first challenge is that we need to get to know who Jesus really is. Am I right? We need to get to know who he really is. Just like the disciples of that day, you and I, as modern day disciples, we need a divine revelation of who Jesus is. Now, there are a lot of people who simply give a nod to Jesus. There are some who just say, Lord, Lord. But I believe that there's a host of people who have discovered that Jesus is the Savior. Aren't you glad for that? Aren't you glad for that? And they've met the Jesus who died on the cross for them. They have trusted in him as their substitute. They have believed in him and trusted him. They become born again from heaven. Amen. They've been saved, as we would say it in spiritual terms. But I believe that those people who are like that, they need to press in. Because you see, Jesus, he is the Savior, but he's much more than the Savior. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm grateful for the shed blood of Jesus. Amen. Aren't you grateful that he's the Savior? Aren't you grateful that he died on the cross, was buried, and on the third day rose again? But I've got news for you today. If that's the only Jesus you know, is that he's the Savior, you got to come into a new revelation of who he is, because he's much greater than that. He's much more powerful than that. Yes, then that's just one aspect of who he is. But let me tell you something. He's also the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's also the mighty healer. He's also many great and mighty things. Spoke with a woman this week whose son attends a church where they don't believe that Jesus heals. They don't believe that her son needs healing. He needs faith for healing. And so as she's visiting that church, she says, yes, we're praying for healing for our son. And the people, when she says that, they just kind of look at her with a blank stare. I feel sorry for them. You see, their Jesus is powerful enough to save them from their sins, but he's not powerful enough to do anything in healing in this day and age. They need a revelation of Jesus as the healer. Come on. I don't want to be guilty of putting Jesus in my little box. Amen. I don't want to be guilty of trying to contain him into my thinking and my way of doing things. Come on. Because let me tell you something. I've discovered this about Jesus. He's bigger than I can even imagine. He's greater than I'll ever know. And let me tell you something. You could spend a lifetime reading this word about him. You could spend a lifetime getting to know him. And let me tell you, it's like a diamond. He'll continually reveal more and more aspects of his character and more aspects of his personhood. Come on. He is God. He's the Son of the living God. Come on, church. Paul said this. He said, I want to know him. Let me tell you, that's not knowing about him, right? That's knowing him. Is there anybody in the house that says, I know Jesus? Amen? I know him. He said, I want to know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death. And I think that one of the reasons why the church in America lacks the power and authority and the strength that we should have is because we have not experienced the Jesus that the disciples know, or the Jesus that the Bible reveals him to be. And so the question is still, who do you say that I am?